little girl, Ella, she was only 9 years old when her world started to revolve around every breath she took. Everything started with a mild asthma, but quickly escalate and deteriorate to very severe, very frequent episode of asthma, requiring more than 20 hospitalizations. As you can imagine, after each of those episodes, the little girl and her teeny body were gasping for air, completely exhausted, fighting with an invisible enemy, and then finally, unfortunately, she lost that battle. And Ella tragically became the first person in the world to have in her death certificate air pollution. Ella was living on a very trafficked area where she was exposed to high level of pollution when she was walking to the school or when she was playing outside or even when she was on her way to the hospital, which was very often. So where do you think she was living? Maybe you are thinking that she was living in New Delhi, Mexico City. I'm sure that there are many options. But no, she was living in Europe. She was living in London. She was not even far away from the trendy street of Notting Hill. Would you ever imagine that in Europe, the levels of pollution could be so deadly? You know, the problem with Ella is that she had very good doctors and clinicians taking care of her. But unfortunately, any time she was discharged from the hospital, she was sent back to the environment that was contributing to her death. And this is something that is unacceptable. We cannot live in areas where our homes are the ones that are putting us at risk. Or at least, I was not expecting that to be the case when I was working with Médecins Sans Frontières in Central America, in refugee camps. I saw a lot of kids with asthma cases because they were inhaling, you know, the combustion of the open fire where their mothers were cooking. But I was not expecting to see that in Europe. So, are you ready to accept this toxic air that we are breathing? But you know, air pollution is not just an urban issue. The pollution can travel and knows no border. And it can come from very long, far away places and reach places where we will never imagine that we will have air pollution, like mountains or even remote islands. And I'm sure that you all remember New York just the last year, this summer. We had the wildfires in Canada, and we saw how that smoke and haze came to the city of New York. I'm sure you remember those apocalyptic images of New York with a blanket of smoke and haze coming from the wildfires in Canada. But this is unfortunately the place where we live. This is the world we are living where, I'm afraid, we are breathing air, and breathing is the entry door to the toxic air that then goes to our lungs and the rest of our body. And we are breathing an air which is toxic as a result of the fact that human activity is the one releasing that toxic air, sometimes or too often, as a result of our consumption of fossil fuels, the combustion of those fossil fuels that are literally killing us. Unfortunately, the story of Ella, which is very tragic, I'm sure you will agree with me, is only one little piece of this environmental crisis that is threatening all of us. An environmental crisis that is a pawn of our society now and that will require action. Climate change is strengthening lives of people all around the world, and is doing it through extreme weather events, and I think you know what I'm talking about. Heat waves, again, I know you are talking what I am talking about. Increase on disease burden is responsible as well for disrupting our food systems, and of course, responsible and true the bad quality of the air we breathe. So climate change is part of the environmental crisis. But then, if we look at air pollution, believe it or not, and this is a horrible figure, is killing, there is no other word, is killing 7 million people annually. 7 million deaths caused by exposure to the air we breathe. And this is happening through chronic respiratory diseases and lung cancer, but it's causing as well stroke, it's causing as well heart attack, and this is probably the worst part, is affecting our brain. It's damaging our cognitive development, is associated with dementia, and is causing damage that it might even reduce our development, the brain development. So I need to be very quick on what I'm telling you because our capacity to understand is going down every minute due to air pollution. You are still there, aren't you? You are still smart and intelligent and following what I'm saying. Good, I have little time now. And air pollution is responsible as well, associated with diabetes, associated with low birth weight. Anyway, is associated, is affecting every single organ in our body. So how scary is that? Are you scared enough or can I? Okay, let me still go because there is even more. Sorry if I am scaring you. The last piece. The environmental risk factors. Environmental risk factor, what is surrounding us, is responsible for 12 million deaths every year. 12 million deaths that could be avoided. This is the positive part. If we take an action, we can prevent 25% of the global burden of diseases. Means the global mortality could be reduced by 25% if we take action. So the question is, are we taking action? Well, you know, for decades, we have been discussing about this issue. A lot of discussions have been going on about the health of the planet, what are the decisions we take on tackling the causes of climate change. Let me be very honest with you, we are not yet there. I'm just back from New York, where the leaders of the world were gathering, all our prime ministers and big figures were gathering there to look at the health of the planet and taking measures against climate change and our big environmental crisis. We are not yet there. Let's be honest, we are not yet there. We are lacking political will. And that means that we need more action. We need legislations. We need policies in the name of health. We know very well the dangers, and we know it from ages ago. We have thousands of scientific papers demonstrating how air pollution is affecting our health. We know that what that means even from the 50s and even before. People have the right to breathe. It's a very nice declaration on the human rights, the right to breathe clean air. But around the world, we don't have a legislation telling us what are the limits on the toxic air we are breathing. We don't have a legislation as we can have an agreement for the Paris Treaty for climate change. Even worse, we don't have an obligation globally to measure the levels of air pollution, to monitor the levels of air pollution. Most of the people don't know, they don't have a clue about the quality of the air we are breathing. I don't know, I don't want to do a survey here, but maybe you don't know what is the quality of the air we are breathing here. And 40% of the countries around the world, they don't know even, they don't even have the little monitoring system to check the quality of the life in the place they live. So we are not yet there. I think we said that already. China. 2008. China 2008 was celebrating the Olympic Games. This might sound a clue for you. Sounds familiar, Olympic Games? Yeah, okay, I knew it. So China was celebrating Olympic Games, and in preparation for that, they took a series of restrictions and legislation to make the country look good. So they put in place restrictions for the coal power plants. They need to reduce emissions. They asked as well the polluted cars to clean the streets of Beijing, and they encourage a very good public transport system. They disencourage the use of cars by increasing the price of the gasoline. They close chemical plants in Beijing. And you know what? That worked. That worked. We look at the statistics and we saw, and we have the demonstration, that the hospital admissions related to respiratory diseases and cardiovascular diseases decreased dramatically, decreasing death as well in the medium and long term. So what is telling you? It's telling us that if we take action, if we are serious about this, it can work. Unfortunately, China decided to not to enforce those measures after the Olympic Games and the political and international attention disappeared. Those measures were not enforced. Yet, when we know that those measures work, yet 99% of the world is breathing an air that is not respecting the recommendations of the World Health Organization, the organization where I work, and those guidelines are so needed for the governments. We are advising the governments what are the levels of the quality of air that will protect the health of the population. And still, they are not there. So, you know, 10 years ago, a friend of mine was requested to go and work, a journalist. She was requested to go to Shanghai to work there. And she has two little kids with her. And apparently when she arrived there, their kids started to have respiratory bad conditions and they were visiting the hospital very often. After 4 years of being there, she went back to Spain on a very rural area, and she told me that her kids never again visited an hospital because of the asthma symptoms that they had in Shanghai. So she asked me a horrible question. She asked me, since you have the capacity to calculate, you have the methodology to do it, can you tell me how many months or years on the life expectancy of my kids I have reduced because I have exposed them for 4 years to bad air quality? I never answered that question, obviously. But it's dramatic to see that we are not yet there. So what can we do it? Can we just say we don't do anything? I'm sure that you will tell me, what is the point of me recycling? What is the point of me on coming to the tech talks by bicycle instead of driving a very polluting car? What's the point of eating less meat or buying less clothes or something like that when we have wealthy people around the world traveling on jets, private jets, corporations polluting dramatically, and even our governments not taking measures to transition in a way from fossil fuels and taking us to a more renewable, sustainable, clean, healthy sources of energy? So what's the point? And you are right. But you are right to a point, because here we are fighting for our health, so we have no choice. It's not about the environment alone. It's not about, you know, we are destroying the planet. We are destroying our health. So do we have a choice? I don't. And I want to call on any of you to be a pollution fighter. A pollution fighter, let me see. I'm sure that there are lawyers in the room. I'm sure that lawyers can do miracles with legislation. They can do even good things, you know, the lawyers. Very recently, in France, a Bangladeshi man who had asthma, he was about to be deported to his own country in Bangladesh. And then his lawyer, very successfully, claimed that he couldn't be deported because the conditions of air quality in his country will accelerate the disease and probably even cause premature death. Well done, lawyers. With legislation, we can move mountains. Don't think that you don't have power. We all have power as an individual. Of course, we need the governments to take action. Of course, we need legislation. Of course, we need the corporations to do something different and moving to a greener sources of energy and different ways of patterns of consumption. But you have the power. We all have the power. I'm talking to the influencers here. I'm talking to those who can change and glamorize all of those actions of riding a bike instead of taking a flight, or eating less meat, or taking the public transport. We all have the power of that. So now I'm inviting you to breathe deeply and calmly. That breath will bring you as well a decrease in the levels of cortisol, and then reducing your fear, so you will not feel disempowered. At the contrary, you will use your breath to speak out, not to have an intoxicated breath, but a speaking out, not taint, but indifference, but again, using your skills and your voice to influence. Health will be the motivation to stop pollution, because if it's not health, what else? Thank you.